sure got quiet, didn't it? Welcome to Southwest Church. Good to be able to get close to the Lord, just to spend time with Him. Maybe to speak to Him, and maybe just to sit and wait. Listen for God's heart. Thank you. presence. I sing beneath the banner of your wings.
Show up Wednesday night at 6:30 for our regular Bible study. That one's fun too. Not as much fun as ours, but that one's fun too. Hey, our proclaimers, those boxes that proclaim God's word in other languages, you guys have done awesome. We have a proclaimer now. The Southwest Church has proclaimers. These are in countries where largely about half the people are illiterate. So even when the Bible has been translated into their language, most people, or at least half the people, can't read it. A lot of times these are people that are hearing God's word in their own language for the very first time ever. And now the Southwest Church has put proclaimers in the Philippines. We've put a proclaimer in Cambodia. We've put a proclaimer in Tajikistan. We've put a proclaimer, in Poland. We have one in Poland. We have one more somewhere. You can look up there. In Afghanistan, we have at least 5 military Bible sticks from the 101st Airborne soldiers who specifically asked for it are getting a military Bible stick where they can listen to God's word while they're out on the front line. So pray for the soldiers, pray for the people in these countries. They're going to be getting these proclaimers. Cool? Also, it says program helping possibilities. If you want to help out during the week, if you have, hey, I have Tuesday afternoons off, or I have Wednesday mornings off, and you want to start helping out at the church some, cleaning, straightening, weeding, whatevering, let Tony know. Write it down on your blue tearaway in your program and say, hey, Tony, I'm free on Monday afternoons. Give me a call. We'll get it straightened up. It's cool when you guys say to Tony, hey, call me if you need help. He's never going to call you. Just say, hey, I can be here this day. How? What can I do? He'll tell you what to do. He's good at telling people what to do. But just let him know when you're free, okay? This is a good week to jump in and get involved. Cool? All right, let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you again for this church. Thank you for these people. God, thank you for being willing to meet with us, for wanting to meet with us anytime. Every time we come to you, God, you're willing to meet with us. God, help us truly want to. Help us truly be willing to quiet ourselves and meet with you, draw closer to you. We love you. We praise you. We do want you to change our hearts. Again, please help us just be willing to do what it takes to get closer to you. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Getting close to people that you like can be kind of nice. Looks like he's figured out an escape. That's not an escape. But it looks like the kitty's made a buddy. Ta-da! Success. Getting together with someone you like can be kind of nice. Said to the early service this morning, if you're lucky enough, that's a good Bible word, right? If you're lucky enough to trip over a group of people who are kind of like you, and they kind of like you, how good is that? If you're lucky enough to trip over a group of people, talking about church now, you're lucky enough to trip over a group of people who are kind of like you, and they kind of like you, well, that's great. Now, the bottom line is not how I feel, but how God feels about it. The most important thing is not whether I'm happy with it, but am I becoming more holy with it? So it really is more a matter of the scriptures and my satisfaction. It is more a matter of, am I getting God's word here rather than just kind of like hanging around? We're trying to hit both. But getting together with someone you like can be kind of nice. Can you get together with anyone that you want anytime? Are there some limitations? Huh? You can't always get together with everybody you like. Sometimes we might be separated by distance. You have friends or family that live kind of far away and can't get right with it, might be separated by distance. Maybe you're separated by decisions. Maybe they chose to leave. Maybe there are just some decisions that made it so that you can't get close. I said to the early service, because they're not as spiritual as you are, they may be separated, I don't know, maybe by the Secret Service or restraining order, something like that. There may be reasons that you can't get close to the people that you want to get close to. You can't always get as close as you'd like any time you like, but sometimes we just keep trying. I think that kitty's pretty determined to hang on to that tail.
Oh my God. He sat on her head.
Are we ever that determined about anything? You can't always get as close as you'd like any time you like. But God says, while there may be some people that you want to get close to and you can't, you never have to be away from Him. God says you can get close to God anytime you want. He said it like this in Psalm 73, but as for me, the nearness of God is my good, the psalmist wrote. You are near, O Lord, he said in the 119th Psalm. You know, this past week has been pretty rough for our country, huh? The first part of the week looked like it was pretty bad, and then it went downhill from there. People missing their loved ones, missing their hearts because they've been taken away in death, huh? At least one of the five, a couple of the Dallas policemen who lost their lives this week. At least a couple of them were church guys. It looked like they knew the Lord, loved the Lord. I don't know about all of them. One in particular was a member of Watermark Church there in Dallas, and He had been a faithful part of that ministry for years and years and years. I think he was a vet, and the folks knew him, whether he was in uniform or out of uniform, whether he was armed visibly or not visibly armed. They knew to look for him in the kids' ministry. Whenever they walked in where the little ones were learning about Jesus, they knew they could find him there, standing guard, watching out for the little ones. That was his thing. And he lost his life this week doing that very thing, protecting protesters. If you're part of the family, how could you not ask God, what's going on? God, where are you? Maybe I'm not very spiritual, but you ever find yourself asking a question like that? God, what's going on? You lose a loved one, you lose a job, you lose stability, you lose something. God, where are you? God, why aren't you helping? God, why aren't you doing? Huh? Psalm 34:18, the Lord is near to the brokenhearted, and he saves those who are crushed in spirit. Psalm 145, the Lord is near to all who call upon him. Hebrews 10 says, let us draw near to him with a sincere heart in full assurance of faith, that because the Bible says we can come close, we can come close. James 4:8 says, draw near to God and he will draw near to you. So we know from the Bible that we have God's permission to come close. We know from what the Bible says that God is close. We know that by faith, not because I believe real hard, but because the Bible says that God is close. Now I believe that God is close. That's faith. I believe it because God says it. Not I believe it because I think real hard. Ooh, I believe it. Or I believe it and there's no doubt in my... That's not faith either. Faith is I believe what I believe because God says what he says. The just shall live by faith, the Bible says. That's what that means. People who are right with God do what they do because the Bible says what it says. It's not because a preacher talked you into it. It's not because you just know it and you're knower. It's not because you think the Lord spoke to you and you got holy goosebumps and God spoke to you in a fortune cookie. You do what you do because God says what he says. That's living by faith. By faith, I know that God is near to me. But in my feelers, in my feelings, sometimes I feel like he's far away. Who prayed, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? What wicked sinner was that? It was Jesus, the Lord of glory. My God, why have you forsaken me? He knew that God the Father was near, but there are those times that we don't feel that he's near. You have a God who wants to be close to you. I don't know if you'd want to be as close as God wants to be to us, but this is just kind of an example of being near to something. This guy took his drone and he sent it up in the middle of a fireworks display. These fireworks look pretty cool from the ground. I think they look very cool from the middle of the display. It looks a little dangerous. Do you think God wants to be right in the middle of your life? Or maybe it's too dangerous. Maybe your life is too volatile and he wouldn't want to be near. You have a God who wants to be close to you. You have a God who wants to be right in the center of your display. You have a God who wants to be right in the middle of the explosive, volatile, whatever the heck is going on in your life this week. You do have a God who wants to be close to you, no matter what's going on. God's close to you and he'd love for you to get closer to him. Does that make sense? God is close to you and he wants you to get closer to him. Now, how much closer? The Bible says that God is omnipresent. Yeah? It's a 25-cent word that means he's every place at the same time. Omni, all. Present, present. He's omnipresent. He's here. He's there. He's everywhere. If he's with you in Las Lunas or the Northeast Heights, can he be with me in the Southwest Valley? Yeah. Can he be with a sinner some other part of town and be with the holy ones here? God is omnipresent. God is everywhere at the same time. God is here, but he wants you to come near. Well, how far away is he? He's not far away at all. But we are making a distinction between what we know by faith, I believe it because the Bible says it, and what I feel in my feeler. Yeah? God's close to you, but he'd love for you to get closer. I don't know if you can tell, but a zookeeper keeper had been watching over the giraffes and some of the other animals for about 25 years and got sick, is terminally ill, and one of his last wishes was to be able to get close to the animals that he had taken care of for so many years. So they brought his bed close to the giraffes, and they're just loving on him, getting close to him the way he was close to them for all those years. It's kind of sweet, kind of sad, isn't it? God's close to you, and he'd love for you to get closer to him. My shirt is close to me. He'd love for me to get closer to my shirt. It kind of doesn't make sense. But again, we're making a distinction. God is omnipresent. He's right here. God couldn't be any more near to me now. God couldn't be any more near to me later than he is now. He'll never love me anymore. He'll never love me any less. God is present. God is here. But he wants me to draw near. What do I know by faith? What do I feel? Sometimes we don't feel all that close. But the Bible tells us that you have a God who knows you. You have a God who cares about you. You have a God who really wants you to be closer. You, O Lord, are a God who is merciful. You are a God who is gracious. You're slow to anger. Thank you, Lord. And you're abounding in steadfast love. You're overfilled with love. You're sloshing over. I'm a little old man. If I was in a car accident, I would not spill one drip. But when I'm walking, I'm tipping this thing all the time. When the cup is filled to overflowing, that's the picture. Slow to anger and overflowing with love. Not just love that's kind of wishy-washy, a steadfast love. God, your cup runneth over. God, you love me with an abounding, overflowing, steady love. You love me with that love. You love me with that kind of faithfulness. Zephaniah 3:17. The Lord your God is in your midst. What does that mean? In our midst. Where is he? Right here. The Lord your God is in your midst. He's a mighty one who will save. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you by his love. He will exult over you with loud singing. The part I want us to look at is he will quiet you by his love. You go through a week like the folks are going through in Dallas and in Baton Rouge and I think Athens and New York and Dallas again. And people are hurt. People are being hurt. People are being killed. That uneasiness, that, God, where are you? God, what are you doing? We sense a lot of that. And I don't know that we personally are related to those who lost their lives. But even from a distance, we can feel some of that angst, some of that sadness. God wants to bring a stillness. God wants to bring a calm in the storm. God wants to bring a peace through all of the turmoil. He will quiet you with his love. I thought it was interesting in the earlier service we were looking at the part. The Lord your God is in your midst. He's a mighty one who will save. We know God is a savior, as a deliverer. He will rejoice over you. That's kind of cool. He'll rejoice over you with gladness. He will exult over you with what? Loud singing. You ever picture the Lord singing? That's him singing, not us. I wonder what he sounds like. You think?
I think he sings like
Think he sounds like Bob Dylan? Think Johnny Cash? Elvis?
Thank you for a moment. Thank you.
God gets excited over your presence. God loves for you to be near. There's more joy in heaven, the Bible says, over one sinner who repents. Yeah? Than the rest of us who've been saved for a while. What am I, cheese? Well, not exactly, but this one just got saved. The Bible says there's rejoicing in the presence of the angels, and we like to imagine the angels singing, and yay, hallelujah, that kid got saved. It's not the angels singing. There's joy in the presence of the angels. Isn't that what the Bible says? Did I say that wrong, babe? Now that I said it, I'm thinking, is that right? Yeah. There's joy in the presence of the angels. That means the Lord is the one rejoicing. The Lord is the one that's, yay, he exults over you with loud singing. I think that's pretty cool. 1 Peter 5, 6, humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at the proper time he may lift you up. Cast all your cares upon him, for he careth for you. Cast all your anxieties. One of the cool things about getting saved is you never have hard times anymore, right? Yeah. You never have a problem, you never have anxiety, never have, oh, what now? You never found yourself saying that, have you? Someone's like, it piles on and piles on, and okay, already, God. But he knows. He knows. So what am I supposed to do with it? Well, suck it up and quit whining. That would be my response, right? Suck it up and quit whining, you crybaby. But God says, cast all your cares upon me. I care for you. You can bring your burdens to me, not me. I'll pray for you. You can bring your burdens to me. I can't do anything about it. You know, I can feel for you. You know me, I'll try to help you. I don't want your help, I just want a hug. I don't hug, I'll hug you, but I'm going to help you. Yeah, helping often sounds like nagging, by the way. I will help you with words. There are times that sometimes, I just want somebody who understands. God can do both. Humble yourselves, therefore, under the mighty hand of God, so that at just the right time, he may lift you. He may exalt you. Cast all your cares upon him, all your anxieties. Why? Because he cares for you. How deeply theological is that? It's just kind of nice. Cast all your cares upon him because he cares for you. We have a God who wants to get close. We have a God who loves it when you try to get closer to him, Romans 5:8. But God commended his love towards us. God showed his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Did he wait for you to clean everything up before he chose to get closer? Did he wait for you to clean it all up before he chose to come closer? Wait for you to clean it all up before he chose to come. God showed his love for us in that while we were still sinners, he gave his life. Jesus gave his life. How many of your sins were in the future when he died for your sin? All of them. All of your sins were in the future. You weren't even born yet when Jesus went to the cross. God showed his love for us in that while we were still sinners, even before we were born, he knew who we'd be. He knew who we would be. He knew who. I barely know who you are, and I know you're sinners. He knows everything about you. God showed his love for us, and while we were still sinners, he chose to die for us. He wanted to be close. Romans 8:37, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. We are super victorious, super victors through him who loved us, through Jesus. And I'm sure, by the way, how close is he? Is he this close? No, he's this close. How close is he? He is so close, Paul says, that I'm sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation, if I've left anything out, I'm sure nothing will be able to separate you from the love of God. How close is he? So close that nothing could ever separate you. That's kind of close. Close enough that when you're overwhelmed with burden, you can still bring it to the Lord. Is he always going to fix it? Not the way we'd like necessarily, but he knows. Not just that he knows. Hey, I know. Just, again, suck it up and quit whining. I know. It's more than that. Again, remember the point is not bringing you to the place where you get everything you want. Once you've come to Christ, now the point is coming to the place where God gets everything that he wants. What's the point in my life? Get everything I want. When you come to Jesus, now the point should be giving him everything that he wants. So why am I still struggling? Why am I still suffering? I'm not sure. Maybe you're making bad decisions, but maybe you're making great decisions. And the name of the game is to continue that process of purification, continue that process of sanctification. When you gave your life to Jesus, I was 18. I was an old man already. I was 18 years old when I gave my life to Jesus. That was a couple of years ago. From the time I gave my life to Jesus, from the time I came to Jesus, to the time that I go to be with Jesus, I'm in the process of becoming more like Jesus. I gave my life to the Lord. Someday I'm going to go to be with the Lord. In between, I'm becoming more like the Lord. Justification, my sins were forgiven. Glorification, I'll be with the Lord. Everything in between this life is sanctification. The struggle, the suffering, the satisfaction. Your blessings, your burdens, the anxiety, the anticipation, the big stuff, the little stuff, all the stuff, all of it is working together for your good. So that you get everything you want? No, it's working together for your good so that he gets everything that he wants. Because from the time that I come to Christ until the time that I go to be with Christ, I'm in the process of becoming more like Christ. What is that going to take? I don't know. What are you going through? That. What the heck? But that, More struggle? I guess. I don't know. More suffering? Sorry. More satisfaction? Maybe. More money? Yay! Less? I don't know. Because this life is not about you getting everything you want. Not if you've come to Christ. Now, Jesus said if you've not given your life to Him and you choose not to give your life to Him, then you might as well eat, drink, and be merry. You might as well party because tomorrow you're going to die and not go there. Jesus said that. If you're not going to get saved, you might as well eat, drink, and be merry. You might as well party because you're going to die and go to hell. But if you've come to Jesus, someday you're going to go to be with Jesus. Everything in between, you're becoming more like Jesus. You want to know how to get closer to God? Jesus said, deny yourself. I don't like that one. What else you got to say? Die to yourself. I don't like that one. What else you got? You know, everything Jesus says is pretty much, Tony, you ought to be able to come to the place where, like the Apostle Paul, you could say, it is no longer I who live, but Christ who liveth in me. That's a tough one, man. I'd rather just pray and you send me stuff. Isn't that what prayer is? What's the primary purpose of prayer? What's the primary purpose of everything? It's to glorify God. But having said that, the primary purpose of prayer, of course, to glorify God. But the primary purpose of prayer is not so much to get from God as much as it is to get with God. Shoot, that could be a bumper sticker. Write that down. The primary purpose of prayer is not so much to get from God as much as it is to get with God. Now, the fact that you're still dealing with stuff, the fact that you're still struggling, the fact that you're still suffering, again, maybe you're just making bad decisions. Fix that. But if you're making good decisions, you're making godly decisions, and you're still having a rough time, rest assured, all things are working together for good. That doesn't mean everything is good. It doesn't mean everything's going to work out the way you want. Again, from the time I came to Jesus to the time I go to be with Jesus, everything is making me more like Jesus. What is it going to take to make me more like Jesus? Everything you're going through. I guess. That's a bummer, isn't it? Not really. Because it's not about me. It's not about you. It's about Him. And I'm convinced that God is so close that neither life nor death, things present, things to come, height, depth, as a matter of fact, I can't think of anything, Paul says, that could separate you from the love of God. He's here, but He wants you to be near. You have a God who loves when you try to get closer to Him. You may have to struggle. You may have to squirm. You may have to turn on your head. Who knows the kinds of things you're going to have to do to get closer to God, but He loves when you try. That ought to be our life. God is here, but He loves it when we come near. You may have to stand on your head. You may have to twist. You may have to turn. You're going to have to give stuff up. You're going to have to start doing things. What is it going to take? It kind of doesn't matter. Because the joy of the Lord, that's my strength, the joy should come in the presence of the Lord. The Bible says there's joy in the presence of the Lord. I think for most people, the presence of the Lord brings guilt, conviction. You don't know everything. It's kind of like a wife who can read your mind. I'm not responsible for everything in there. I didn't put most of the stuff there. But it's still there. And God knows even more than that. You have a God who knows everything about you. And He loves you. You have a God who from the beginning, not just from the beginning of your life, from the beginning of time, from the beginning, when there was no time, when there was no planet, when there was nothing, Christ was slain. He was as a lamb slain before the foundation of the world. Before you were born, Jesus knew that you'd be born. He knew that you would blow it. And He knew that you would trust Him. And He chose to die for you. Before the foundation of the world, Jesus chose to come close to you. Now we get to choose to come close to Him, whatever it takes. Now you've come to Christ. You've come to Christ. If you haven't, then don't listen to anything else. Right now, go to the Lord and say, God, I'm a sinner. I hate my sin. I can't stop sinning, but I'm a sinner. I hate my sin. Jesus, please forgive me. Please save me. Get saved right now before you listen to anything else I say. The rest, I've heard it. It's not that good. Kidding. Come to Christ. That's the first step. But now that you've come to Christ, you're becoming more like Christ. Okay? So in this process, because you believe Jesus, this is kind of cool. This is all through Scripture. But the passage we're looking at this morning, because you believe Jesus, you're saved, you're strong, and you're set. Because you've come to Jesus Christ, you're saved. God forgave you. He forgave your sins. And you haven't sinned since then, right? Yeah, He's still forgiving. Yeah. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and we make God a liar. Of course we still sin. And so we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ. We go to Christ and we confess our sins, and He forgives us and cleanses us from all unrighteousness. You're saved. God has forgiven you. And you're strong. You don't have to pull yourself up by your bootstraps. You don't have to work this out. You don't have to figure it out. We have the responsibility to work. If a man doesn't work, he shouldn't eat. We have the responsibility to be responsible. But the Bible says that everything I eat, everything I breathe, everything I consume, everything I enjoy is a gift from God. That's what the Bible says. I mean, from the time my kids were little, we tried real hard not to teach them that you can't have that because we don't have enough money. No, maybe you can't have that because I don't think you should have it. Well, when we have enough money, then you can. It's not about money. Well, why do we have a job? Why do we go to work? Because we have to buy groceries. Well, yeah, all that is part of being responsible. But the Bible says God is the one who gives me what I eat. Well, that's not His name on the card that I had to swipe through. I know. But that's what the Bible says. God's the one who gives me what I eat. God's the one who gives me what I breathe. God's the one who gives me this life. He wants us to be responsible and be responsible. But He's the one supporting you. He gives you life. He gives you breath. He gives you forgiveness. He gives you that fortification. He gives you that, I'm going to keep going. I'm going to keep going. And when you feel like you can't, He's still there holding you up. You're saved. He's forgiving you. You're strong. He's supporting you. And you're set. You know what that means? It means you can't get unsaved. If you're born again, you can't get unborn again. Almost 62 years ago, wow, how old are you, Mom, Dad? Almost 62 years ago, I gave my life to the Lord. I mean, I was born. No, I didn't get saved that long ago. How old are you? I gave my life to the Lord 40 years ago, something like that. I was 18 years old. But 62 years ago, Jake and Margaret Chavez had a bouncing baby boy. And I was cute, too. I'm cuter now, but I was cute when I was born. Never mind, Eddie. I'm telling the story here. I was just beautiful. I was just cute. All right. I'm 18 years old. I give my life to the Lord. Let's say when I'm 20 years old, I decide, you know what? I don't have enough money. I need more money. Well, I can get another job. I can save money, or I can rob a bank. I like that rob a bank one. So I go and I rob a bank. And on the way out of the bank, I've not only decided to rob a bank, but the guard on the way out, that was bad. Okay, I robbed a bank. I killed somebody. I sped in the getaway car. I ignored a stop sign. I drove into Mexico illegally. You know, they have laws about crossing the border, going the other way. I get to Mexico. I've robbed a bank. I've committed murder. I sped. I ran a stop sign. I entered a country illegally. 2 days later, I'm starting to feel pretty bad about it. So I called Dad on the phone. I say, hey, Dad, is my mom there? And yeah, she's on speakerphone. She's right here. You're talking. Say hi to your mother. Hi, Mom. What did you do? Like that, right? Because I'm so stupid, right? And so I said, I feel really bad. That sounded like Clinton. Sorry. I did not. But I'm guilty, so I'm not going to say. So I did all of these things. I tell Dad and Mom, I'm really sorry. And Dad says, you sorry thing? I knew you'd never amount to anything. You sorry good for... Why can't you be good like your sister and your brother? And well, fine. Is that the way you think about... Well, that's the way I think about you. And you fritzerism. So now I cuss at my mom and my dad on the phone. Then I slam the phone down. I go to a Mexican lawyer and I change my name to Rufufio Rodriguez. So now I've stolen... I know, bad, right? Stolen, I murdered, I sped, I ran a stop sign, I entered a country illegally, I dishonored my mother and my father. you can't change the fact that 62 years ago they had a bouncing baby boy. They might even off me, but you can't change the fact that I was born. Yeah? I gave my life to Jesus when I was 18 years old. I just happened to be 18. I was 17 when Crazy Carl started preaching to me. A year later, I gave my life to Jesus. God had been chasing me down until I found him, you know? I gave my life to the Lord. When I was born again, the Bible says I was born of God. Jesus said, you're in my hand. My hands are the hand of the Father. No man can pluck you out. I couldn't get unsaved. That doesn't give me a license to sin. In fact, the Bible says, if I say that I'm saved and then I go out and live like the devil, you better go back and look at that decision, because you might have made a decision, but you may not be a disciple. You may not be born again. That once saved, always saved, I believe it, because that's Bible. That's not a Baptist thing. That's a Bible thing. Once you're saved for eternity. But if you prayed a prayer and you think it's okay to go out and live like the devil, maybe not so much. If you think it's okay to pray a prayer and live for yourself, that's not it. You've never heard this before, but if you can do bad and not feel bad, that's very bad. Because if you're truly born again, the Holy Spirit lives inside you and He flicks you on the ear spiritually. He makes you feel guilty if you don't already. If you can give your life to Jesus, if after praying the prayer, if after getting saved, you think you got saved, if you can do bad, but you don't feel bad, that's very bad. You may not be born again. You may not be saved. If you're saved, He's going to continue to support you, and you're set. He's going to keep you. The Bible teaches that once you're in Christ, you won't get out of Christ. That shouldn't make you feel trapped. Should make you feel, yay, God, thank you. But now my life isn't my life anymore. When I gave my life to Jesus, I gave my life to Jesus. And He's near. He's here. He wants me to continue to come near. John 10, my Father who has given them to me is greater than all, and no one can snatch them out of my Father's hand. No one can take you away from God. No one can pull you away. You can't lose your salvation. That should give you hope. That's a good thing. That's a good thing. But now that I've come to Jesus, until the time that I go to be with Jesus, everything is me becoming more like Jesus. So how should I live my life? Figure out how to get everything you can for yourself. Does that sound right? No. We know it in here, but we hear some of these TV preachers and say, oh, all I have to do is believe it and receive it? No. No. I belong to Him. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. So God, I know you're here. Help me want to be near. Help me want to get closer to you. Help me get so close to you that maybe I even bug you. You think it would bother the Lord for you to try to get that close? You think it bugs Him? Get off! Like Lauren chasing me around, stalking me, always wanting to hug me and hook a leg around. Get off! You think it bugs me, Him, God? You think it bugs God when you want to get closer? Of course not. He's here, but He loves it when you try to get near. It doesn't bother Him. He loves it. If you've come to Christ, you can get closer to Christ. Look, you've come to Christ, you can get closer to Christ. The passage we were going to get to, we're already 2 minutes over time, and now we're just now getting to the message. So go home and next week I'll finish. Not even. Ephesians 3:12. All this month we've been talking about freedom. This is just another passage that deals with that. In Ephesians chapter 3, the Apostle Paul is saying, this is awesome. This is so cool. I'm the least of the saints. I'm the sinneriest one of them all. I'm the chief of sinners, he says someplace else. I am nothing, but God chose me. God said I could tell the Gentiles how amazing Jesus is. He's this one full of mystery. He's full of blessing. He's full of glory. And I get to come to tell the Gentiles that they could come to Him. They can come with confidence. They can come boldly before the throne of grace, like the writer of Hebrews says. Paul says in chapter 3, verse 12, in Him, in Christ, and through faith in Him, in Christ, we can approach God with freedom and with confidence. Four things he says in this passage. We're just going to fly through these. God is omnipresent. God was right up in your grill before you got saved. He's omnipresent. Before you got saved, He was here. He wants you to come near. Now that Jesus has paid the price for sin, let me tell you four of the big benefits you have that you've come to Christ. He said, you can come to God without a priest. He says, in Him, in Christ. All of this is in Him. Now, I'm not saying this as someone who grew up in the Catholic Church. I did grow up in the Catholic Church, and we did have a priest, but that's not why I'm saying this. I'm saying this because the entire Old Testament economy, the whole Old Testament religious system was built on a middleman. God is holy and you ain't. So you need somebody to go before God so that you don't get chamuscad. Is that the right word? Yeah. So God's a holy God. You're unholy. So you needed a go-between. So between a holy God and a sinful person, you had a priest who would represent you to God. But now that Jesus Christ paid the price once for all, Jesus Christ presented Himself a lamb slain before the foundation of the world. He laid His own life. He laid His own blood down to pay the price as a sacrifice for your sin. You no longer need a middleman to get to a holy God. You have Jesus Christ Himself. You don't need a mediator. You have the one go-between, Jesus Christ, the one mediator between God and man. So because He is the one who brings you in, you are in Him, you can come to God without a priest or a preacher. Drag, I just lost my job. You can come to God without a priest in Him too. You can come to God without a penalty. The Bible says you come to God through faith in Him. Again, faith isn't, oh, I believe. Growing up, when you wish upon a star, does it matter where you are, or wherever that song goes. But all the time growing up, I'd been taught that starlight, star bright, first star I see tonight, I wish I may, I wish I might, you know that one, right? Have the wish I wish tonight. Well, I was a kid, what did I wish for all the time? A pony. In middle school, we got one. Found out you gotta feed them, you gotta clean up after them, you gotta watch them, had I known, I would ask for a motorcycle right off, but I didn't. When you come to God, you come through faith. That doesn't mean that you believe real hard. I believed real hard I was going to get I believe. That's not faith. Some people teach that faith is believing something without doubt. That's not faith either. You can believe whatever you want. But the Bible says that faith is believing what I believe because God says what He says. It's the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. The evidence is not I could touch it. I know it in my knower. What the heck does that mean? I just know it in here. I just know it. I just believe it. I'm going to get that job. Well, you could be wrong. I just believe I'm going to get healed in Jesus' name. Okay, fine, whatever. But that's not Bible faith. Bible faith is you do what you do because God says what He says. Bible faith is you believe what you believe because God says what He says. I can come to God without penalty. That means I can be forgiven. I can be saved because I believe Him. And He said, if I come to Christ, acknowledge the fact that I'm a sinner, repent of my sin, that means I hate my sin. I don't have the power to no longer sin, but I do have the desire to no longer sin. I repent of my sin. I hate my sin. I sin all I want. I sin way more than I want to sin. I hate my sin. Through faith, the Bible says, I can come to Christ. I can repent of my sin. He'll forgive me. He'll redeem me. He'll save me. So I can come without a priest. I can come to God without a penalty. The Bible says I can come to God with prayer. We may approach God. How do I approach God? I die and I go to heaven. I get on a bus. And how many transfers is that between here and there? And approaching God today means I pray. I come into His presence. And again, remember the primary purpose of prayer, of course, to glorify God, but the primary purpose of prayer is not to get things from God. The primary purpose of prayer is to get with God. You can approach God. Did you come to Him? Do you have to talk all the time? No. It's okay to shut up and listen. One of these, two of these. I'm not good at that. It's okay. You come to God. You can approach Him. Four. You can not only come without a priest, without a penalty, you can come to God with prayer, and you come to God with peace. You can come before Him with freedom and confidence. The Bible says that before you got saved, you were at enmity with God. You were at war with God. Did you know that? You were in a long fight with a short stick. You were fighting God, and you were not going to win. But the Bible says that once you come to Jesus, you're no longer at war with God. Now you're at peace with God. You still have unrest. You still have turmoil. You still have anxiety. You know, I'm sorry about that, but the answer may not be more medication. It may be more repentance. It may be a change. Not the change. A change. I don't know what you guys are laughing at. It may be a change. It may be stop what you're doing, or it may be start what you're not doing. You can come to God with peace. If you still have that anxiety, you still have that unrest. We're still in the flesh. There's still going to be stuff going on. I mean, to be sure, there's still going to be stuff that. You're still going to have in your life. But I ought to be able to surrender that to God. I don't just mean to talk like a preacher. I mean, we really ought to be able to trust God with that. How happy was John the Baptist in jail for standing righteously? How good did Jesus feel that they were plucking his beard and slamming him and hitting him with whips, that he was nailed to a cross? It's not always happy, happy. The name of the game is not figuring out how to pray so that God gives you happy, happy. The name of the game is coming to God in prayer, getting into his presence, so that no matter what's going on in my life, I can just trust that from the time I came to Christ until the time that I go to be with Christ, He's making me more like Christ. What is that going to cost? Whatever you're going through. You can try to change some of it, but it's what you're going through. Because the process is not to make you happy. The process is to make you holy, to make you more like Him. Ephesians 3:12 again, in Him, in Christ, and through faith in Him, in Christ, we may approach God with freedom and confidence. That's kind of cool. That means He's here, but you can try to come near. So, I mean, it kind of begs the question, should we try to get closer? Should we try to get closer to Him? I guess. If you have any questions about how, come talk to me. I'll give you a big old list of things. But it's not about do this and don't do that. It really is about believing what He says. And I want to live for You now, Jesus. I want to give my life to You, and until I go to be with You, help me become more like You. Everything I'm going through, I just kind of trust You. The things You can change, change. If I keep running out of gas, put gas in sooner, you know? I mean, you can change some of the hard stuff in your life. You know what I mean? You can change some of it. But the stuff that seems like you have no control over, from the time you come to Christ, make sure you've come to Christ, until the time you go to be with Christ, you're becoming more like Christ. He's already here. You can choose to come near. So if you've come to Christ, get closer to Him. It's just good. There's a peace that passes understanding. There's a joy unspeakable and full of glory. And most of the people around you, they won't understand why you're still okay when everything around you isn't so okay. But that's okay, because you know. All things are working together for good, to those who love God, to those who are called according to His purpose. I trust that you've been called. If not, then give your heart to Him now. Jesus, I'm a sinner. And I hate my sin. If you still don't hate your sin, if you can still justify your sin, then I didn't waste your time, but you can't do a whole lot with what I talked about. If you still haven't given your life to Jesus, that's the place to start. If you still think it's okay to mess up, then not so much. But if you've given your life to Jesus, follow Him, follow Him, follow Him. It's not about praying a prayer. Jesus said, I wish Jesus had said, pray this prayer. I wish Jesus had said, pick up a blue book and do the, you know, four spiritual laws, and at the end, pray this prayer and sign on the dotted line. I say that, but that's not what Jesus said. Jesus said, come follow me. A la modi. Can't I just sign something? Can't I just pray a prayer? Yeah, you can, but that's just the beginning. You become a disciple when you choose to follow Christ. You do what you do because he says what he says. Follow me, Jesus said. Lord Jesus, help us follow you. Thank you for your promise. Thank you for your presence. Thank you for your peace. Thank you, God, that you said that we have the freedom. We have access to come to you. You said that you are omnipresent. You're every place all the time. But you've given us permission to come near to you. So God, thank you that by faith we can believe. Thank you, by faith we can know. And thank you, Lord, that even in time through our feelings, we can find an assurance of that salvation. We can find an assurance of this process of sanctification. But Lord, I pray that more than anything else, we would just trust you, that we would just believe you, that we would turn to you, repent of our sins, and say, Jesus, I give up. Please forgive me. Please change me. Please use me any way you want. I love you, Jesus. Thank you for loving me first. In your name we pray. And everybody said,
yes.
Amen. God bless you guys. What's going on?
Your spirit is urging our hearts to obey.
How you been?
Hey. Church, arise and sing for the joy. Sing for the joy we've found. With our lives we shout out your praise.
Church.